Father, we pray for your spirit to be the teacher. Lord God, we thank you for the example that we have in the Apostle Paul, and what an intercessor. How great that Mark has that suggestion to intercede, because that's what we see in the life of Philemon. So, Lord God, just speak to our hearts, and we just thank you that, Lord God, no matter what has happened in our past, Lord God, you take care of our present, and we're just so thankful that you've got our future. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Does any of you guys remember that song from the 80s, Freedom, by George Michael? Okay. Sorry, Mark, but I'm not sorry, because that's really the theme that we see in Philemon, is that a runaway slave is presented with, he's free, he's born again, and his master is given the opportunity to free him, but in a sense, and his name is Onesimus, the runaway slave, that's us. That's our story, everybody in here. Before Jesus Christ, we were a slave to our own passions, our desires, and our sins. And I was thinking about, the power that you and I have in things that we've done, addictions, strongholds that the Lord has had in our, or that we had in our life, and the Lord has brought us through those. So we can sing freedom, okay? When I hear that song, instead of freedom, I hear Jesus. So sometimes you hear a secular song and you like to incorporate different words in there. So I won't sing for you this morning, because that'd just be embarrassing. But, you know, it could pop up later. So, Mark, again, I'm sorry. Okay. So, it's funny, though. The opening lyrics to that song is, I won't let you down. I will not give you up. I got to have some faith in the sound. It's the one good thing that I've got. And that's what the Apostle Paul has. He's given it to people that he gets to come in contact with, and it's freedom. Now, what's interesting, though, is for you and I, we not only get to know freedom from the things that held us down before Christ, but, you know, sometimes things stick on after Christ, okay? A lot of us don't just instantaneously get saved and we walk in utter perfection, waking up with Altoid breath, having those around us composing songs for us all the live long day. We find out that the process of sanctification is a process. It takes time. One of the best things that we can say to our kids or the people that we care about when we make a mistake is, you know what, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And I'm growing in the image and likeness of Christ, but I'm not there yet. In fact, will you pray for me? And in fact, if I could have had the opportunity to do it again, I would have done differently. And it's a great way to approach people, because if people come in here every morning and think that to live for Christ is to walk into utter perfection, then they're going to say, well, what's wrong with me? How come I'm not living for Christ in a person who doesn't seem to make mistakes? Well, we all do. Amen. And the good news is we have somebody that shows us grace and mercy and forgiveness. And this is the great thing about grace. Grace says, yeah, you blew it. Sure you did. Keep going. Condemnation says, I'm scum. I did all these things. And the Lord says, yeah, I know what you did. But my son provided the perfect sinless sacrifice. So you don't have to just look at your sin. You can be forgiven. You can move on, okay? So this is the shortest of Paul's writings, 25 verses, written about 6 years earlier than 2 Timothy, his last epistle. This letter is a masterpiece of graceful, tactful, and delicate pleading for a forgiving spirit. Philemon was a well-to-do Christian friend of Paul, living in or near Colossae. Do we have that slide for Colossae? Colossae. I give you Colossae. Yes. Okay. His name, Philemon, means loving. And, you know, the book doesn't deal a lot with doctrine, problems, or theology like we see in Corinth or Galatians. Remember, the Galatians had problems with the Judaizers. Colossians had problems with the Gnostics. But Philemon gives us insight to the kind of person Paul was, and I think into the kind of person that we are. Because it's interesting how forgiveness, doesn't it play a major role in day-to-day Christian living? You've got things, I think of different, I almost had mannequins here this morning, but maybe some people are praising God that I don't. But I'm thinking about, there are kind of the people in your life that you have to forgive, but they live in Saskatchewan. So you don't see them all the time. So forgiving with them, depending upon what they've done, is one thing. But having to forgive people that you're constantly rubbing elbows with, that can be another thing, okay? And so that's where I think Philemon comes to play, okay? So its practical theme is brotherly love, which sounds like a city with a big old Liberty Bell, Philadelphia. Paul extends himself in love to a man named Philemon. He entreats him to extend brotherly love to, again, a runaway slave named Onesimus. I might call him Oni, okay? It seems that he ran away and he took some money, according to verse 18 of Philemon. Anybody know how many slaves were in Rome at about this time that this was written? Anybody want to guess? How many? How about 60 million? In the Roman Empire, not Rome, in the Roman Empire, they far outnumbered the free citizens, okay? Athens, for example, at its zenith, 21,000 citizens, 10,000 foreigners that didn't play head games, that lived there, and there were 400,000 slaves. That was bad. It was cold as ice is what that was. Oh, I know. It gets worse. That's right. It's urgent. So many were slaves from the war that had been carried away, brought home from defeated enemies. Many were born slaves. Many sold themselves into slavery. Many were orphaned through circumstances and grew up then as slaves. And they ran the gamut from somebody who was highly esteemed. They could be bought at today's value between $50,000 and $100,000, and they would be considered a member of the family, and they would not want to go free. They would enjoy that, okay? But there's also great abuse, okay, as well. And so in a lot of ways, and there's a big difference between the Hebrew Old Testament slavery that God had provision for and the Roman slavery, because they took it to a new low, okay? Many slaves were treated harshly, probably due to paranoia, you know, that they might revolt, have a convoy, you know? So Onesimus, Oni is a runaway slave from Philemon who lived in Colossae, has gone to Rome, which was quite a trek, and it was a great place to get lost in the crowd, booming metropolis. Somehow, we don't know how, but Onesimus comes into contact with Paul. Who knew? The Holy Spirit. And he's chained to a quaternion, which was a guard, Roman guard, that would have changed every 4 hours through shifts throughout the day. Philemon does not present the standard that we see in Exodus 21:24 of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And there's a reason why God had that provision in his word, because you and I are prone to getting revenge. And all I have to say is two words, and you understand what I mean. Road rage. You cut me off? I can't believe you cut me off. Okay. I didn't think I had road rage until I was a passenger in my daughter's car. Then I found out I do experience road rage. So this rather displays the high standard of Christ loving the church. We see that kind of forgiveness. And this book is an example of a private leopard letter, not a private leopard, that was very common in the first century Greco-Roman world. This letter probably fit on one papyrus sheet, kind of like 3 John. It's uncertain to whom it was primarily addressed. Let me give you some background, kind of technical here. It could be addressed to Philemon, but also Apphia and Archippus, compared to Colossians 4:17, or in some sense, the entire house church, because back then they had home churches that met in houses. This letter provides a window into the pastoral methods of Paul, and we're getting some insight into home churches of the first century. Philemon and Colossians are closely related. Both letters have the same origin, same people give greetings, same closing. Tychicus delivered Colossians, traveled with Onesimus. You can see that in Colossians 4, verses 7 and 9. The date of this letter is linked to one of Paul's imprisonments in Rome. We think the first imprisonment. We've just been through the book of Acts, okay? So it's not that long ago that we looked at that. Remember the first time he was under house arrest, he wasn't in a dungeon, wasn't in a jail cell, actually lived in a rented room with a continuous Roman guard. Paul was in jail in the early 60s, not the 60s, as recorded in Acts. But he was released, and he wrote the pastoral letters, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, Philemon. And then he's rearrested, killed before June 9th, AD 68, which is Nero's suicide. And the best educated guess for the writing of Colossians, Ephesians, and Philemon's, again, is first imprisonment with Paul in the early 60s. It's different than the pastoral epistles because it's very personal, and it's not a general letter, and it was also meant to be read to the home church, but primarily to the individual, okay? Some think that Onesimus was caught in Rome and was chained to the same guard as Paul. That would have been a funny coincidence. As we read this, keep in mind, again, that you and I have been slaves, unable to pay a debt. He paid a debt he didn't know. I owed a debt he couldn't pay, right? Paul is interceding. He's going to ask Philemon to forgive his debt, to receive him as one of God's children. And this was radical during this time of slavery. So as we read through, you can put yourself, Martin Luther said, we are all the Lord's Onesimi. And think about, try to remember what God has done for you, what God has done for me. So on the other side of the coin, you've got Philemon. He's been wronged. Everybody in this room also has been wronged. The good news, the bad news, is that it will happen again. Okay, so this is very practical. It's good for us to learn from this, all right? Some of us are going to be challenged to forgive somebody that we're still angry at. So why don't we go ahead and jump in? Philemon, verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. So he says, Paul, a prisoner of Jesus Christ. And he's somebody who has released every aspect of his hopes and dreams under the auspices of Jesus, guiding and directing his life. Aren't there many things in life that can hold us in prison, in chains, captured? Okay, anger, bitterness, lust, pride. Sometimes it's circumstances, okay? Unfairness, alcohol, drugs, you add whatever it is, okay? And those chains make it difficult for us to experience peace. And Paul here is saying that he's in jail because of Christ. So he's not complaining, he's not whining, but he's explaining to Philemon that Jesus Christ has him in this position. And so now he's going to explain one of the reasons why Jesus has him in chains. It's for, among other reasons, to have led Onesimus to the kingdom. Now, that's a mature perspective. When you and I can undergo pain and difficulty and trial and lengthy difficulty, pain, and trial so that somebody else gets saved. But do you think in heaven Paul was like, oh man, I'm so bummed out. You know, I spent all that time and, you know, here's Onesimus and he's in heaven, you know. No way. High fives are abounding in heaven. It's a glorious day in heaven, okay? So wouldn't it be great if you and I were more like Paul? When we feel chained by our circumstances, imprisoned in this situation or that place in life, realizing that God is allowing us to be in this situation that we're in. So when I'm whining, and I will, because I'm Chuck Wine, okay, about where I'm at in life, really, haven't I lost sight of the fact that I really am a prisoner of Jesus Christ? And in that, there truly is freedom, right? One person said, to be a slave of Jesus is to be a king. To be a slave to yourself means you can't help but serve your bodily appetites, and we're not surprised by the unsaved, right? They don't have the Holy Spirit inside of them convicting them, okay? To be a slave to money or sex or power is to live under tyranny of a cruel master. And it's not that way at the beginning, because at the beginning it looks fun and it's attractive, and we see it in the movies, we see it on TV. But to be a prisoner of Jesus Christ is to know freedom, okay? I'm not even sure if George Michael knew freedom. So not to be bound in the sin nature of the flesh. We walk in the Spirit based upon our feeding habits, right? It's funny, we always pray, you know, before worship practice, you know, what's your week been like? And you know what we're talking about in a lot of ways is what our feeding habit was like in the course of the week. What did we feed upon? What did we allow ourselves to ruminate on, to think about? And then what kind of tools, what kind of spiritual tools do we grab out of our bag, okay? So are we feeding on his word? Are we making his thoughts our thoughts? If so, we know what it's like to be free. Does anybody know what Timothy's name means? It's honored by God, or honorer of God. So he was converted through Paul's witness on the first missionary journey to Derbe, Lystra, in Acts 26:1. At times, it looked like he functioned as Paul's secretary or scribe. Paul includes his name because Paul's getting older. Some commentators think he's about 60 years old. He's in the process of getting people ready to accept the ministry of Timothy. So he says, to Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer, and then verse 2, to the beloved Apphia, Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. So Philemon is an active member in this church at Colossae. He's only mentioned in this letter, okay? So Phil knew Paul while Paul was in Ephesus at the school of Tyrannus, teaching for 3 years. He would have had come 100 miles hearing of Paul, and then we see Apphia, which a lot of commentators think is his wife. There's no biblical evidence for that. If that is Philemon's wife, she would have been in charge of slaves in the household, so this letter would get her attention. Also, they think Archippus is Philemon's son, but I love how he's described. He's a fellow soldier. This is what I'm looking at right now, fellow soldiers. Because you and I, we're at war for St. Joe, and even beyond St. Joe in our prayer life, okay? So what's the plan of attack? Okay, it's to destroy Satan's schemes. Mark prays that probably every Sunday morning. What makes an impact in this city for Christ? It's fellow soldiers. 2 Timothy 2, you therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Now this is the hard part. Here's the rub. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Paul has been enduring hardship, but it's for a cause, it's for a direction, it's for a purpose. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. You know, we read that and we move on. But when I'm a soldier for Christ, and it's not Calvary Chapel, okay, and it's not for any person, but when I'm a soldier for Christ, then what somebody else does is on them, because I'm not fighting for them. I'm fighting for the Lord, right? Okay? So Jesus is my CO, my commanding officer. We're in a battle zone, and you know what? We're not to get overly just caught up in the affairs of this life. Our kingdom is not here. We are pilgrims. You know, we're just setting up tents here. These bodies are temporary tents. Amen. So it says, to the church in your house. And you know, for those of us that desire to minister full time, we are pastors of our houses. We do have home churches, okay? So we are to train our kids in the ways of God, to teach them the word. We pray with them. You know what? Have communion as a family. It's a great thing, you know? Because what we're doing in the house, our goal is that they're going to do that outside of the house, right? That's why it says above that door, it says this, you're now entering your mission field, okay? So build your family because your house is your church. Husbands and wives, we can read together. Single people have relatives. We got Spirit-filled Wanda being able to bless her relatives and the people that she is able to impact. And this family, Philemon's family, they opened up their house to minister, okay? They had meetings of some sort. Remember, again, there were no church buildings, so there was no high ceilings like this with bat poop, okay? All right, until the 3rd century. That's when they got the bat poop. So more than likely, this is a portion of the church meeting in the house. I don't think the whole church could fit in the house. Homes weren't really that big back then. But what there was in Colossae was what there was in many cities. There were house churches scattered around that really function just out of simple necessity without a larger building to meet in. So the earliest Christians didn't really have property of their own. For church buildings, we know that the Jews had their synagogues. Christians met in the homes of their members. And they would gather and there would be a city bishop that would be over those house churches. Verse 3, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's that typical Pauline greeting, grace and peace. charis is the free gift of God, and Paul mentions peace, shalom, the Hebrew greeting, because Paul knows, now Paul knows, but Chuck needs to know, okay, and Gary needs to know, bless you, that peace is not based upon circumstance. It's based upon the person of Jesus Christ, okay? So he's sitting here, it's just amazing, he's chained to a Roman guard as this is being written, you know? What's the conversation like, you know? How do you spell beseeched? I don't know. I don't know what that's like. But he's talking about God's free gift, and even though physically he's chained, he's the freest man in Rome, Paul the Apostle. So he says, I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers. Now, I love this. I love this. I think when I was first saved, I remember hearing about a lot of Holy Ghost meetings where people would be sweating as they prayed, and they get on their knees and they beat the chairs, you know, and I felt the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen, you know, and it was just very, I'm sure very passionate, you know, a lot of emotions were involved. But here we see Paul is not praying long, intricate prayers for Philemon, but he's praying often, frequently, okay? So loving somebody doesn't mean you have to pray for them for 20 minutes a day. It's just praying often, frequently, mentioning them in your prayers. Also, you've heard of preventive medicine, okay? This is preventive prayer. What do we normally do when we pray for somebody? We pray when we hear that somebody's sick, somebody's in a difficult situation, somebody's had a loss, difficult, but typically negative type circumstances. Here, really, it's great to pray for people when things are going well. Okay? Here's why. Because the enemy wants to come against that. God, you've got victory, you're having success, you're walking. Really, that needs to be the time we need to be praying for people, okay? And, you know, you're never going to read in the New Testament where Satan is warring against an unbeliever. He saves himself for believers, right? So those that are walking with Christ, he's not really worried about unbelievers because he's already got them, okay? So his focus is on us. What he wants to do is he wants us depressed. He wants us discouraged. He wants us defeated. He wants us backslidden. He wants us in the midst of problems and troubles and sorrows. And he knows that we're not going to be as effective with people that come our way, so we can pray for each other. And that's what I love about War Room. That has changed my prayer life. I don't know about you. I don't know if everybody here has seen that movie. But it's taking verses of the Bible and praying them for individuals, for circumstances. And personally, I'm challenged to pray through. Not just pray and then forget. You know, in fact, I think a lot of us, when somebody says, hey, can you pray for somebody? We want to pray right then because some of us are older and we do forget. Verse 5. Hearing of your love and faith, which you have toward the Lord Jesus and toward all the saints. If you love Jesus, you're going to love his church. Sometimes you get people that are like, hey, I drink beer and I fish and that's my church. Not according to the New Testament. According to your beer and fishing, I'm with you. That's not church. Because the church are not fish and beer. It's the people. In fact, initially, nobody referred to the church as a building. It was living stones, like Peter wrote about, okay? So John 4:20 says, whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. So we are all different, clearly, without a doubt. You talk to everybody in this room, we are all different, and yet one of the marks of the love of Christ is loving the body of Christ. And that's where we get the idea of koinonia, it's fellowship, okay? It's because faith has works. You know, the interesting thing is, take worship, for example. In the secular world, you play music, you play for you. You play drum solos, you play guitar solos, you know? And you want to sell tickets, and everything gets to be about you. One of the biggest things that we look for when we go to do worship is that nobody sees us. That people come in here from the moment that first chord is played, you guys have an experience with the living God. And if you come away with that and saying, you know what, God moved me, then we've done our job. It's to become invisible, okay? So, again, the concept is that here, that there might be a common sharing of the work of God in your life. So he says, think, Philemon, of all that God has done for you. Now, what Paul is doing is he's going to set him up for the proposition that you need to accept your runaway slave who's now converted back into your life and accept him as a brother. That's a radical idea. But again, Isn't there benefit in just rehearsing all that God's done for us? In fact, if we're not able to do that, it's really incumbent upon us to take the time to look at what God has done, okay? So Paul prayed for Philemon, desiring that the sharing of his faith would become effective, as Philemon understood the work that God did in him. And this is really the foundation for all effective evangelism. Now, we have great resources available to us in the 21st century. There are websites. We have people like Mike Fisher, who is like one of the best online debaters I have ever heard, okay? One of the excellent traits, though, that we can carry in effective evangelism is just telling people, this is how this became real life. This is what God has done. Because when people come in here on a Sunday morning or they come in here on a Wednesday night, they're thinking, is this the tooth fairy and we're reading religion, what man wrote, or is this actually the word of God that's living and it's powerful and it's sharp and it's alive and it changes people? And if I can tell you, this is how God has worked in my life and this is how he has changed me, that's real. And at that point, I've planted, somebody else is going to water, and God gives the increase, and it's really not a pressure situation, okay? So the reason why some sharing of faith is not effective is, you know, sometimes we're not thinking about every good thing that God has done for us. It's a great idea to review. Verse 7. He says, "For we have great joy and consolation in your love, because the hearts," and King James, that's bowels, "of the saints have been refreshed by you, brother." So it seemed from this section that Philemon had the gift of helps. He had the gift of hospitality. As Skip Heitzig points out, Philemon was reaching out to different people in the community without getting all the attention, without being on the stage, okay, not recognized as a pastor. He was in the shadows ministry. Oh my gosh, that's the sign of a healthy church. Because you're doing things and you're not getting attaboys. And you're down there and it's just like right now, we've got people that are loving our kids right now with the word of God. Isn't that a great thing? Okay? So it's the unseen. It's not the famous. Okay? So his gift of helps was serving behind the scenes, refreshing the saints. In 1 Corinthians 12:28, we see the gift of helps. And Paul is saying that other believers are finding rest. They're refreshed in the deepest part of their being. That's where I love that word bowels in King James, because it's kind of, it's what it means is the deepest part of you, where just in your gut, the viscera, okay, you're feeling just the sense of what you want to do for the Lord. So we see that love serves. Verse 8. "Therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to command you what is fitting, yet for love's sake, I rather appeal to you, being such a one as Paul the aged, and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ." I can almost hear like a violin in the background. It's me, poor old Paul. I'm so old, and I just need Philemon for you to do the right thing. And it's a good thing he didn't sell used cars or used chariots back then. But what we see here is a principle that love rarely makes demands. You know, we're getting ready to meet tonight to look at husbands and wives. There should be a lot of people that can make it to come out for that, because, you know what, how is my wife going to respond if I just demand things from her? What kind of relationship are we going to have? Is she going to see Christ in me when I do that? I don't think so, okay? He's got the authority as an apostle to give him a command, but he doesn't. Now, he did that in Galatians. Okay, he assumed apostolic authority, and he did give commands to the church as a father would give commands to his children who were erring. And he had that right. He had the spiritual leadership that God had given him. But you know what? Love seeks to encourage. You can tell the difference. You can't fake love. You can smile. You can say, how are you? But when you really love somebody, you're there, and you care. And you want to find out how somebody's going to fare, okay? That really all rhymed, okay? So, but love lets the other person make a choice. And there are times when you have to make decisions, but true leadership isn't insecure. You don't have to give a command so people know who's in charge here, okay? And again, also, when he says Paul the aged, he could have been speaking about the time that he had in the Lord, not necessarily his chronological age. Verse 10. He says, "I appeal to you for my son Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains." So he hasn't mentioned Onesimus up until this point. Okay? So, and if this is being read out loud, this is in a home church setting. So can you imagine, as Onesimus comes up, I don't know what he was thinking at that time, but I'm sure it was written all over his face. But actually, the custom of that day was they would read letters out loud. That's why we read, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, because it was out loud, okay? Some people used to think that this discounted reading the Bible, and Martin Luther and some reformers actually debated over whether or not deaf people could be saved. It's kind of ridiculous, but now more than likely, by this time, Philemon knew the situation, but as I'm rolling the movie in my mind, sometimes for dramatic effect, I'm thinking, Onesimus? Oh? So he refers to Onesimus as his son. Why does he call him his son? What's that? Because he led him to the Lord. Because remember, he referred to Timothy and Titus as his son. So he's kind of like their spiritual father, okay? They're like his spiritual sons. Verse 11 says, "One who once was unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me." I can't help but think of Pastor Pat when I read this, because this is a play on words. Pastor Pat is the king of puns. Ladies and gentlemen, Pastor Pat Wood. The punster, okay? What does Onesimus mean? Profitable, okay? So he's saying, hey, profitable became profitable. And they're like, ah, ha, ha, laughing, guffawing. And their wives were thinking, oh, my. Oh, my. Oni. So we don't know how he was profitable to Paul, but again, Paul's older. He served Paul while he was under house arrest. He hadn't been profitable to Philemon previously. In fact, he'd been the opposite, at least for a while. But now, basically what Paul is saying is, you know what? He can live up to his name. He's leading up to gently saying, in a lot of ways, that he would like to keep him around for himself. But true servants are rare. Okay? Because they're not doing it for glory. They're doing it because Jesus has changed them. Remember, Paul said in Philippians 2:20 that there was nobody else like-minded like Timothy. Okay? So that Paul felt like Onesimus was a servant of Christ. Verse 12. I am sending him back. You therefore receive him, and that is my own heart. If you read about slave conditions back then, Pliny recorded that there was a servant that accidentally spilled and knocked over a goblet, and they took that slave and they threw him into a pond of water that had lamprey eels, and for entertainment they watched him get devoured. That's what we're talking about, the level of atrocity here, okay? So Roman law gave the absolute authority of life or death over a slave into the power of the master. So this is significant. Again, the Roman Empire had as many as 60 million slaves, but what we're seeing now, what Paul is doing, is something ethical in the body of Christ, because that's not how we treat people in the body of, well, heck, we don't treat anybody that way, but hopefully not. But Onesimus had stolen money, okay? So slavery is only the part of the issue here, and, you know, we don't like thieves, okay? So what's the important principle here? It's Christians reconciling, okay? A lot of times when another Christian hurts us, we feel like that runs deeper because we feel like they should know better. We have a higher standard, okay? So we often pray. Oftentimes when we pray, we think of healing in terms of physical, but I want to suggest to you that sometimes healing is spiritual. Isaiah, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. And that's Isaiah 53. James 5 says, is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord. We know that we're talking about forgiveness of sin. We know that we're talking about physical sickness. But I got to tell you, a lot of times we need healing so that we're forgiving. Because that root of bitterness will take us out. And I'm speaking from experience. I know so many of you have also experienced that root of bitterness. So keep in mind, this is an admonishment from one brother to another to receive and forgive a brother that wronged a Christian. So it's interesting, we see in verses 17 through 19, we see illustrations of substitutionary atonement. Verse 17, if then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. But if he has wronged you or owes anything, put that on my account. Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay, not to mention to you that you owe me even your own self besides. So accept him as you would me. Charge that to my account. I will repay it. You owe me. Okay? Sometimes for you and I, the issue of forgiveness seems like the very absence of peace in our lives. You ever think about Matthew 18:21? That's when Peter came to Jesus and said, "Lord, how often shall my brother Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times?" Jesus said to him, "I don't say to you up to seven times, but to 70 times seven," which makes you think of the VeggieTales, okay? 490, grapes of math, okay? Now, it's interesting. I've heard it taught and suggested that this is the same sin over and over again. And you think, are you kidding me? What am I dealing with here, okay? And it might seem kind of extreme, but let me suggest a different scenario with you. What if you're with somebody, you work with them, or you're in close proximity to somebody, maybe it's in your family, at a workplace, in church, wherever, and they don't change? It's like they're counting up to 490, and you're thinking, what's going on here? Well, the truth is, God is wanting to do a work in me, even though they're the one that have committed said offense. And that's a different perspective, because God is saying, you know what? If they haven't moved to Saskatchewan and they're in my life, God is trying to teach a lesson for me. Now, here's good news, bad news, okay? The bad news is that if we don't learn to overcome it, we'll keep getting that person or other people just like them in our lives. That's not good news. The good news is that if we forgive them, God gives us victory. And then not only that, but you find yourself interested because you're praying in their life and you're looking to see if God's changing them. And God has done that over the years. We've seen people that you'd think when you first meet them, okay. My parents would say, God bless them. Okay, that's what my folks would say. Okay, and you think, wow, we normally wouldn't mix. And then you end up becoming friends with them. Okay, so 490. So who's left to grow in this situation? If we're around them and they're not changing, God is working on us. And what he's doing is he's working on me to change the interior of my heart as I'm experiencing an unchanging situation in the exterior of life. Verse 13. Paul says, whom I wish to keep with me, speaking of Onesimus, that on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. So, again, Paul is letting him know that his purpose, his interaction, is for the gospel. Without your consent, I wanted to do nothing that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. So if Paul did, let's just say, for example, if he did demand or command that he do this, then really Philemon loses the reward because he's just responding to what Paul told him he had to do. But if he does it on his own, by his own volition, then he gets that reward from Christ. You know what's amazing to me as I'm looking at Philemon is that's the character of this man, because this is what Paul has to say about this guy. I thank God, I mention you always in my prayers. I hear of your love, I hear of your faith, and here's my prayer for you. And he sees all these things that are in him, so it is within Philemon to be able to forgive, just like it's in within you and I to do that, okay? We don't always realize that, but if you've got the Holy Spirit, then we have that ability to do that. Now, Onesimus's actions here are criminal. He's possibly subject to a death penalty at this point, so this is life or death. But let's just turn this around. Let's just flip it around. What if he doesn't forgive him? Then that person makes him a prisoner. And then everything he does, he's got that rumbling, that grumbling. I'm going to get him. He stole my money. He's probably working for somebody else. And that isn't that slavery? And I don't think Jesus saved us for that. Amen? Okay. So Paul is saying, look, if this is something that's not from your heart, then it's not even worth it. Verse 15. For perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose, that you might receive him forever. So perhaps that relative, that unsaved boss, that close friend in the body of Christ, perhaps that person that injured you, perhaps that happened so that you might receive them forever. Perhaps that person will come back to you and ask for forgiveness. That happens. Sometimes you and I in this situation, we feel like we're forgotten, but perhaps God's timing is involved in all of it. Perhaps we are a Philemon and somebody has ripped us off, okay? You can just hear the Holy Spirit because he's saying, you know what, I want to do a work in you, Chuck. And maybe if you demonstrate unconditional love for somebody, maybe they'll receive Christ forever. So it's thinking about what's in the divine mind of God as you're going through a situation in your life. Okay, so I know we need to wrap this up. Verse 16, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord? Paul is effectively taking actions that are abolishing the sting of the master-slave relationship and is laying down the foundation for the eventual legal abolition of slavery. In this culture, he could have picketed, right? Wouldn't have helped him. Okay? There were so many slaves, he could have spoke, he could have staged a protest, it would not have helped him. You know what ends up helping him? Love. Loving somebody. Okay? So, verse 17, if then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. So basically when Paul would go to stay at Philemon's house, he'd have a guest chamber for him, and he's saying, look, do the same for him, put him in the guest chamber. But if he has wronged you or owes anything, put that on my account. Again, that's a perfect picture of Christ when he says to us, here's my bloodstained cross, put it on my account. He says, I, Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay, not to mention to you that you you owe me even your own self besides. You owe me your whole life. So put it on my account. Just kind of thought I'd throw that in there. Here's the reality. When the Romans caught a runaway slave, they took a branding iron and they put a permanent F in their forehead for fugitibus, fugitive. For the rest of their life, they would walk around with that big F on their forehead. For you and I, that's what Jesus Christ has done for us. He's removed our sin, our guilt, our shame, so we can walk away, we can walk around day to day without anything like that on us, guilt-free, right? Yes, brother, verse 20, let me have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in the Lord. So actually that word joy is more literally profit. It translates the ancient Greek word oninomai, which is the root word for the name Onesimus. He says, refresh my heart in the Lord. Earlier, Paul said that Philemon was a man who refreshed the hearts of the saints. Now he's telling him how he can refresh Paul's heart. And then he says, he's so convincing, he says, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Now, I know that we read the Bible devotionally, okay? And probably not normally you want to share that like in a teaching kind of application. But you know, when I read this, when I was in 2015, when I was in my devotional reading, it made me think of looking at saints, other Christians, and believing the best in you. It gave me that perspective. He's saying, I know you're going to do more than I can say in this situation. Isn't that a great perspective? Because then you're looking for God to work in the life of these people that are seated around you in these pews here this morning. It's a great perspective. Okay? There's so much in this world that goes contrary to that, and we want to magnify the things that are wrong with each other. How about looking and saying, you know what? God, I know that you're going to do even more than I can pray right now. I'm going to look into Bruce. I'm going to look into Mark. I'm going to look into Sam, and I want to see, I'm expecting them to do more than I can even imagine. So this letter is full of hope. Having confidence, verse 21, in your obedience, I write to you knowing you're going to do even more than I say. But meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be granted to you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, greets you, as does Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, Luke, my fellow laborers. Each of these guys is also mentioned in the conclusion to Colossians, that's 4, verses 10 through 17. Again, it confirms that the letter went to the, both letters went to the same place. Philemon lived in Colossae, and the last verse, you can breathe a sigh of relief. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen. It's interesting. Paul never calls for an overthrow of the slavery system. Yet the principles in Philemon destroy slavery. The changes come when people are changed one heart at a time. In our society, okay, a law is not going to change racism. A law is not going to change, although it helps, the regard for the unborn, but a change of heart will. Okay? And the conclusion of the letter leads us to ask, why is Philemon in our Bibles? In AD 110, the bishop of Ephesus was named Onesimus. And it could have been the same guy. If he was in his late teens or early 20s when Paul wrote this letter, he would then be about 70 years old in AD 110, and it wasn't an unreasonable age for a bishop in those days, so it actually worked. He did forgive the runaway slave. Why don't you join me? We're going to thank God right now for forgiving us. Father God, right now, this morning, as we look at our week that we've had and what's upcoming, Lord God, there can be a lot of baggage. There can be a lot of collateral damage. And so again, Father, we just thank you for the forgiveness that we see in your word. We see the grace and the mercy. And Lord God, we see the admonition to keeping on for Jesus Christ. So fill us with your spirit as we worship one more time. We pray it in Jesus' name, and everyone said,